airstrikes have killed at least 26 Palestinians in the Gaza Strip, including 9 children, as tension in the region has escalated sharply over the past day. In one incident, 7 members of a single family in Gaza were killed, including 3 children.
It is. What happened here is we were sitting outside the house waiting for iftar, the breaking of the fast. An 8-month-old child was killed. Muhammad, who was getting married in 5 days after Eid, was killed. How was this the children's fault? Girls between the ages of 7 and 9 have been killed. How was this their fault? We are just sitting outside the house waiting for the call to prayer.
The attacks came after 700 Palestinians were injured in Jerusalem and the West Bank by Israeli security forces Monday, including a violent crackdown inside the Al-Aqsa Mosque in Jerusalem, the 3rd holiest site in Islam. Hamas responded by firing hundreds of rockets into Israel. No deaths were reported, but police said over 24 people were injured. The tension in Jerusalem has been mounting for weeks as Palestinians have been organizing to block Israel from forcibly evicting dozens of Palestinians in the Sheikh Jarrah neighborhood of Jerusalem to give their homes to Jewish settlers. After headlines, we'll go to Gaza and Jerusalem for the latest. India reported another 330,000 coronavirus cases Tuesday and nearly 4,000 additional deaths, though the true tolls are likely far higher. In northern India, dozens of bodies of COVID-19 victims have washed up on the banks of the Ganges River in recent days. Residents said desperate relatives disposed of the bodies in the river after they could not find a cremation site with open space or could not afford to buy wood for a funeral pyre. On Monday, the World Health Organization declared a new, potentially more transmissible coronavirus lineage circulating widely in India is a variant of concern. In the Czech Republic, mourners lit nearly 30,000 candles Monday at Prague Castle to commemorate the number of victims who've fallen to COVID-19. The Czech Republic has the second highest per capita death toll in the world from COVID after Hungary. Worldwide cases have edged down from record highs set in April, but remain at a dangerous high plateau. Case rates are highest in countries with low vaccination rates. In Geneva, World Health Organization Director General Tedros Adhanom Ghebreyesus called Monday on wealthy nations to stop hoarding vaccine doses at the expense of poorer countries.
The shocking global disparity in access to vaccines remains one of the biggest risks to ending the pandemic. High and upper middle income countries represent 53% of the world's population, but have received 83% of the world's vaccines. By contrast, low and lower middle income countries account for 47% of the world's population, but have received just 17% of the world's vaccines.
COVID-19 cases continue to fall across the United States as more of the population is vaccinated. Nearly half of U.S. residents have received at least one vaccine dose. The number testing positive each day has fallen below 40,000 for the first time since September. The Food and Drug Administration Monday granted emergency use authorization to Pfizer's COVID-19 vaccine for children as young as 12. This is Acting FDA Commissioner Dr. Janet Woodcock.
We know this is a big step for our country. Vaccinating a younger population brings us closer to returning to a sense of normalcy and to ending the pandemic.
The Pentagon says a U.S. Coast Guard ship fired warning shots at Iranian speedboats Monday as they approached U.S. Navy ships escorting a nuclear submarine through the Strait of Hormuz. It was the third encounter between U.S. and Iranian ships in the past month. The naval tensions came as dozens of Democratic officials wrote to President Biden asking him to revive the 2015 nuclear agreement with Iran, which former President Trump withdrew from in 2018. The officials demanded the lifting of Trump-era sanctions, writing, quote, "The only result has been a vastly expanded Iranian nuclear program, increased regional instability, near U.S.-Iran war on multiple occasions, and severe economic sanctions that have contributed to a dire humanitarian crisis inside Iran," unquote. In Colombia, as massive anti-government protests continue for a second week, The city of Cali has become the epicenter of skyrocketing violence against demonstrators by police and vigilantes. On Sunday, over a dozen protesters were wounded after they were attacked by unknown armed assailants who demanded protesters end the blockade of major highways during a series of indigenous-led actions in Cali. Right-wing President Iván Duque Monday announced more security forces would be deployed to Cali and urged indigenous leaders to leave the city. This is one of the protesters.
The president has been making some reforms and changes against the Colombian people, benefiting a few families, big banks, and big international corporations, and placing all tax burden on the country's poorest population.
Nationwide protests started on April 28th against a now-withdrawn tax reform proposed by Duque and have continued to grow amidst increasing poverty, inequity, and police brutality in Colombia. This is a member of the National Strike Committee speaking from Bogota Monday.
One of the basic guarantees we asked for was respect for the constitutional right to peaceful protest, a simple social right. On the contrary, the discourse of President Iván Duque was permissive toward the excess of the security forces.
In Mexico City, hundreds of mothers whose children have been disappeared led a massive march Monday to commemorate Mother's Day and to urge the government to take immediate action against violence and to find missing people. Since the U.S.-backed war on drugs was unleashed in Mexico in 2006, over 85,000 people have disappeared. This is Marisol Esquivel, one of the mothers.
The government never told me, Marisol, I am sorry for what happened to you. They have never apologized to us. They are the ones responsible for allowing the situation to continue escalating. The statistics of missing people go up every day. In Guanajuato and Celaya, 531 people disappeared in 2020.
In Morocco-occupied Western Sahara, dozens of masked agents broke into the home of the renowned Sahrawi activist Sultana Khaya early Monday morning and detained three well-known human rights defenders. The activists say they were taken to the police station in the city of Bouchedour, tortured for 2 hours, then driven to a remote location in the desert where they were dumped. The raid follows months of harassment and assaults against Sultana and her family in and around their home, where Sultana has been held under house arrest since November 19th. It's part of a wider Moroccan crackdown on Sahrawi activists this week. This comes after Axios reported Secretary of State Tony Blinken told Morocco's foreign minister during a phone call in late April that the Biden administration would not reverse President Trump's recognition of Morocco's sovereignty over Western Sahara. For now, the State Department has not confirmed the report. Morocco's occupied the territory since 1975 in defiance of the United Nations and international law. U.S. recognition came as Morocco agreed to establish diplomatic relations with Israel. To see our documentary, 4 Days in Western Sahara, Africa's Last Colony, go to democracynow.org. In Italy, more than 2,000 refugees, mostly from sub-Saharan Africa, Pakistan, and Syria, have arrived on the Mediterranean island of Lampedusa within the past day. Hundreds of the asylum seekers were forced to sleep on an open-air dock after the local shelter surpassed capacity. Hundreds more have been quarantined until they're tested for COVID-19. This comes as at least 5 refugees died Sunday after their boat capsized off the Libyan coast as they attempted to reach Europe. A humanitarian aid group said there could be a new born baby among the dead. In Russia, at least 9 people were killed and 13 others hospitalized after a pair of gunmen reportedly opened fire at a school in the city of Kazan. Russian media reported one of the shooters, believed to be a teenager, was arrested by police while another attacker was shot dead by security forces. School shootings are very rare in Russia. Immediately after Tuesday's assault, President Vladimir Putin said he had ordered Russia's government to immediately begin work on tightening gun ownership regulations. The Washington Post is reporting Trump's Justice Department secretly obtained the phone records and attempted to get email records of journalists reporting on the investigation into Russian interference in the 2016 presidential election. The Justice Department sent 3 separate letters earlier this month addressed to 3 Washington Post journalists, notifying them the department had received records associated with their telephone numbers from between April 2017 and June 2017. This comes as press freedom groups are denouncing the Biden administration for defending Trump's move against the Washington Post journalists and the U.S. government's ongoing push to extradite WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange from Britain. The head of Instagram has apologized after the social media platform blocked and deleted posts supporting a national day of awareness for missing and murdered Indigenous women, girls, and Two-Spirit people. A spokesperson from Facebook, which owns Instagram, blamed a global technical issue but did not provide further details. The company did not specify why the content was singled out. Meanwhile, attorneys general from 44 U.S. states and territories wrote to Facebook Monday urging CEO Mark Zuckerberg to scrap plans to launch a version of Instagram marketed at children younger than 13. The attorneys general wrote, quote, use of social media can be detrimental to the health and well-being of children who are not equipped to navigate the challenges of having a social media account, unquote. The Biden administration announced Monday it's reinstating discrimination protections for transgender people accessing health care, reversing an anti-trans Trump-era policy. The move prohibits health care providers that receive federal funding from discriminating against people based on their gender identity or sexual orientation, extending from an anti-discrimination clause that's already included in the Affordable Care Act. California Governor Gavin Newsom has expanded a drought emergency to 39 more counties after the spring snowpack in the Sierra Nevadas measured well below historical averages. Several other western states are also reporting droughts. This follows a record-shattering 2020 fire season along the West Coast, fueled by the climate crisis. In Louisiana, dozens of climate activists with the Sunrise Movement have begun a 400-mile march from New Orleans to Houston, Texas, demanding lawmakers pass a civilian climate corps and provide millions of climate-friendly jobs as part of President Biden's $2.3 trillion infrastructure plan. And in New York, the federal trial against environmental and human rights lawyer Steve Donziger began Monday. Donziger has been on house arrest for over 600 days and allegations of contempt of court. In 2013, he won a landmark $9.5 billion judgment against oil giant Chevron over the corporation's dumping of 16 billion gallons of oil into the Ecuadorian Amazon. Donziger, who has since been disbarred, says Chevron's legal attacks on him are meant to silence critics and stop other lawsuits against the company for environmental damage. Democracy Now! Spoke to Donziger in March.
Chevron destroyed the Ecuadorian Amazon, and I was part of a legal team that held the company accountable. The decision in Ecuador has been affirmed by multiple appellate courts in Ecuador and Canada. What Chevron did is, rather than pay the judgment that it owes to the thousands of people in Ecuador that it poisoned, it's gone after me and other lawyers.
The outlet Common Dreams recently reported Donziger's trial is being overseen by right-wing Judge Loretta Preska, a member of the Federalist Society. To see our full interview with Steve Donziger, go to democracynow.org. And those are some of the headlines. This is democracynow.org, the quorum.